Hello everybody,
Let's start the class. Today we shall discuss some basic theory of linear systems in normal forms. In the last class we discussed about the technique of this kind of simultaneous system of linear differential equation. And I told you that mainly you can categorize them into two different forms. This is the first category, the category one. And this is the second kind of system of linear ordinary differential equation. We call it category two. Particularly, we call it, technically speaking, its name is in the normal. Over here, we have derivative of variables. Maybe the dependent variables are x, y, and t can be considered as an independent variable, and that is been represented as a linear combination of x and y along with some function of time t. You can consider this t variable t as a time variable or any other parameter. Okay, it doesn't mean that it should always become the time variable. Maybe any other variable, any kind of independent variable. And I told you that if further over here these two functions f1 and f2 become is equal to 0, then this system is called a homogeneous system of homogeneous system of linear ordinary differential equation. Otherwise, we call it non-homogeneous system. So in the last class, we discussed in detail about the category one, and today we shall discuss the detail of this kind of second category of system of ordinary differential equation. We call it the normal form. Okay. And in this class particularly, we shall discuss mainly the theoretical part in the solution of this kind of system, the basic theory. All right. And in this theoretical discussion, we shall present one or two examples. But the technique of solving this kind of differential equation, if time permits, we shall discuss this technique. And if it does not permit, then we shall have to discuss them in the subsequent lectures. So let's start the detailed discussion over here. So in this case, we shall consider this kind of system of ordinary differential equation. And over here in this system, if this f1 and f2 become is equal to 0, then that system become then that system is called homogeneous system. Now, if you consider this example over here, in this example, if you look at this system, in this example, this dx dt is equal to twice x minus y, and this dy dt is equal to 3x plus 6. On this right hand side system, over here these functions f1 and f2 are not present. You see, this is a linear combination of x and y, and this is also a linear combination of x and y. So we can say that this system, this 7.62, this system is a homogeneous system of differential equation. However, if you consider this kind of system over here, some function of t is there apart from this this linear combination in between x and y. We have one more extra term, that is the contribution for non-linear from this non-homogeneous part. Similarly, over here, apart from this linear combination, we have one extra function or one extra term, that is actually constant over here. So this is an example of non-homogeneous system. Over here, you can see that this system and this system this is twice x minus y minus 5t. If you look at these two systems, this much part and this much part, these two are actually common portion. Alright, over here twice x minus y is there, and in the second equation 3x minus 6y is there, in the second equation 3x minus 6y is there. So in these two equation, the homogeneous part of this equation, that homogeneous part is same. And apart from the homogeneous part, there is one more extra portion in this second set of equations, that is the non-homogeneous contribution. Now, in order to solve this kind of equation, we need to know how can we solve this kind of differential equation. This is the same technique as we solve the ordinary differential equation for a function of a single dependent and independent variable. You see, suppose we had this kind of differential equation, say dy dx, or maybe the second derivative dx squared plus 2 into dy dx plus y is equal to maybe say something like that, x squared. Now in place of this x, let me write the dependent variable as t, because we are considering some dependent variable as t. And in place of y, let me write the variable x. Okay. So now over here, when we solve this kind of differential equation, what we do, we actually neglect the right hand side portion first. And what we firstly do, we try to find out the solution of this equation. And this equation is called the auxiliary equation. Alright. And what we do, we generally consider a trial solution like x is equal to some constant, suppose capital A into e to the power of m into t. And sometimes we call it not auxiliary equation, sorry, I made a mistake. This is called subsidiary equation. And now if we put this solution x is equal to e to the power of mt in this equation, and then we get this kind of relation, that is called the auxiliary equation. M square plus twice m plus 1 is equal to 0. That is actually the auxiliary equation. Okay. This subsidiary equation does not involve this extra term, and this is also, we can consider this one similar to the homogeneous part. The homogeneous part of the original equation, of this equation number one, if we call it this equation number one, then we can say that this is actually the homogeneous part of this given differential equation. So now if we solve this auxiliary equation, then we get two values over here. We get repeated values, m is equal to minus 1 and minus 1, and in this way we generally construct the complementary function. Complementary function, that is actually over here, that would be what is complementary function? Complementary function would be is equal to say c1 plus c2 into t into e to the power of minus t. Because of this repeated root, we shall have this kind of expression c1 plus c2t into e to the power of minus t. Okay, so now this is the technique of solving this subsidiary equation, or the homogeneous part of that given differential equation. And afterwards, what we do, we compute the particular integral. And over here, the technique of particular integral, that would be equal to 1 by say d square plus twice g plus 1 operated on maybe t square, something like that. I'm not going to compute this expression. Just let us denote it by say x suffix p of t. We would get some function of t. This is t square. We would ultimately get some kind of function of t. And so the final general solution, general solution, that is equal to x is equal to the complementary function plus this particular integral. That is the technique of solving this kind of differential equation. So complementary function means this expression. So let us write it over here. That is equal to complementary function plus this particular integral. So in this way, we generally solve this this kind of differential equation. The process is exactly same whenever we consider a system of linear differential equation. And in this solution process, what we firstly do, we generally firstly consider this system and we try to find out the solution of this system, and that would give us the complementary function of for the solution of this this kind of non-homogeneous system. And after computation of the complementary function, we shall try to find out a particular integral of this non-homogeneous system, and accordingly as we got the final result, the solution of the complementary function plus particular integral. That is the basic technique. Okay, so over here, we know what is the solution. That is, this is the formal definition that a solution is actually the collection of two functions. One is f and another is g, and these two functions should have continuous derivatives in the interval a less than is equal to t less than is equal to b, and satisfy this differential equation, this kind of differential equation. Okay, this kind of differential equation. So if we put x is equal to f and y is equal to g in this kind of differential equation, then we'll get this relation. That's right. So that is, that would be the solution, and in that case we say that x is equal to f of t and y is equal to g of t is the solution. So we know that this is a solution. This is a general, this is a known, well-known definition. This is the formal, formally just I am introducing the solution. Now, the main portion that I would like to discuss over here is that over here we got a solution of this system. Of which system? 7.62. So let's firstly mark over here 7.62, and for the sake of discussion, I am splitting the screen. Hopefully the discussion will be a bit easier. So this is 7.62, this equation, and I am moving over here. So what we got by certain technique, today I am not going to discuss that technique. All right, by certain technique we got this solution. Now, how did we get this solution? We may compute this kind of complementary function. Today I am not going to show you the computational process. It would take a certain time. Dx dt. Dx dt is equal to twice x minus y. And dy dt. That is equal to 3x plus 6y. So this is the given system, and its solution. Its solution is x is equal to e to the power of this 5t, e to the power of 5t. X is equal to e to the power of 5t, and y is equal to minus 3 into e to the power of 5t. Minus 3 into e to the power of 5t. Okay. Now, over here, how did we get this solution? I am not going to talk about this solution. Now, the result is that, do we have any other solution to this differential equation? We may have any other solution to this differential equation. And in this kind of differential equation, this was the general category of differential equation. This was the general category of differential equation. Alright, this was the general category of differential equation. And now suppose this equation, this system of equation over here, the corresponding, the homogeneous system, what would be the homogeneous system? The corresponding homogeneous system would not have this much parts. And by certain technique, that technique should be discussed in the subsequent lectures, not today. By certain techniques, suppose we have two different solutions. One solution is this one, x is equal to suppose f1 of t, and y is equal to suppose g1 of t. Second solution, suppose x is equal to f2 of t and y is equal to g2 of t. Now you see, in this case of single differential equation, we considered two expressions, y like this, two arbitrary constant c1 plus c2 into e to the power of t. And what do we have this kind of arbitrary constants? Because you see, this can be written as c1 into e to the power of minus t plus c2 into t into e to the power of minus t. And that can be written as c1 into some function f1 of t plus c2 into another kind of function, maybe f2 of t. So what is f1? You can say that f1 is equal to e to the power of minus t and f2 of t, that would be is equal to t into e to the power of minus t. It should be over here f1 of t. Now you can check that this f1 and f2, these two are linearly independent. The question is that what is the definition of linear independence? What is the definition of linear independence and what is the definition of linear dependence? One can check that linear independence means, suppose if we have two constants, c1 into f1 of t, not c1, k1, because I have already used c1 and c2, this kind of functions. K1 into f1 plus maybe k2 into f2 is equal to 0. And if this is satisfied for all value of t, maybe t belongs to certain domain of definition, maybe say a comma b, okay, and if this is true, then it would definitely imply that k1 is equal to 0 and k2 is equal to 0. If this happens for all choice of k1 and k2, then we say that these two functions f1 and f2 are linearly independent functions. This is exactly same as the definition of linearly independent vectors. As you have studied in vector algebra in probably 11 and 12 level mathematics or physics. Okay, so this is the exactly same definition of linearly independent functions. Now in this case as well, we shall have two solutions, and these two solutions, if these two solutions are linearly independent, the question is that what is the condition under which these two solutions become linearly independent of each other? Over here the answer is exactly same. One condition is that this expression should be equal to zero, and similarly for the function g, for the function g1 and g2, this relation should give us the only possible solution, k1 is equal to 0 and k2 is equal to 0. This is the definition of linear independence of the functions g1 and g2, and this is the definition of linear independence of the functions f1 and f2. Okay, so if these two are linearly independent, now you can ask me one question, sir. Do you always need to verify this condition that these two functions are linearly independent or dependent, etc.? That I shall answer in the subsequent lectures, but for the time being, at least just for the sake of discussion of this theory, I'm just saying that these two should be linearly independent. Now how can we directly check whether these two are linearly independent or not? That I shall discuss later on. All right. So if these two functions f1 and f2 are linearly independent, in that case we can write the solution of this reduced system. Solution of this reduced system means the solution of this homogeneous system that would behave like the complementary function. So today I shall discuss mainly this much part, the solution of this homogeneous system. So if we get this kind of linearly independent solutions, then one can say the complementary function of the general solution, or solution of the homogeneous system, the solution of the homogeneous system would be x is equal to over here c1 into a1 of t plus c2 into f2 of t. And of course, what is y? Y is equal to again c1 into f1 of t plus c2 into f2 of t. All right, so this would be the solution of the homogeneous system. Okay, the solution of the homogeneous system where c1 and c2 are two arbitrary constants, where c1 and c2 are two arbitrary constants. Okay, c1 and c2 are two arbitrary constants, and in this kind of cases, now you can ask me, how can we find this f1, f2? Oh, I made a mistake, this should be g1. Okay, g1, and over here it should be g2. All right, so x is equal to c1 into f1 plus c2 into f2, and y is equal to c1 into g1 plus c2 into g2. That would give us the solution of the homogeneous system where c1 and c2 are two arbitrary constants. Now you can ask me, how can we verify that these functions f1, f2 and the functions g1, g2 are independent of each other? How can we verify this result? And in order to verify this result, we have the one idea that is called the idea of Wronskian. What is this? W-R-O-N-S-K-I-A-N, Wronskian, which is denoted by capital W. And over here, Wronskian is actually a function of t. Why? Because the Wronskian is actually a determinant. What kind of determinant is this? Let Just a minute. Determinant. That would be the determinant f1 of t, then f2 of t, then over here g1 of t, and then g2 of t. Determinant. This is the determinant, and each and every member of this determinant are actually function of t. So altogether, this total expression will be a function of t. That's why I'm writing that Wronskian is a function of t. And it can be proved that if these two functions f1, f2, and these two functions g1, g2 are independent of each other, then this Wronskian is not equal to zero. So this Wronskian not equal to zero means that these two functions, I am writing as a set, these two set of functions, f1 of t and g1 of t, and the second set would be f2 g2. F2 g2, f2 of t, and this second set of function g2. These two solutions are independent of each other. So if you want to check the independence, you can compute the Wronskian and check whether this Wronskian is zero or non-zero. If it is non-zero, then we can say that these two solutions are independent of each other, and therefore this is the general solution of the homogeneous system. And further, if this Wronskian is equal to zero, okay, if this is equal to zero, if this is equal to zero, then they are linearly dependent. I should stress on this term, linearly independent and linearly dependent. So if this Wronskian is not equal to zero, then we call it linear. This two solutions, this solution and this solution, are linearly independent. And if this this is equal to zero, then these two solutions are not linearly independent. They would be rather linearly dependent of each other. So this is the definition of linear independent solution and linear dependent solution. You please go through the statements of this theorems only. We don't need any proof in this case. All right, so if x is equal to f1 and y is equal to g1, this is one set of solution, and x is equal to f2 and y is equal to g2, this is the second set of solution of the homogeneous linear system. Then one can say that x is equal to c1 into f1 plus c2 into f2 plus y is equal to c1 into g1 plus c2 into g2. That would be a solution of the homogeneous system. This is one result. And regarding Wronskian, these are the definition of linearly independent system of solutions. And this is the definition of linearly dependent system of solution. Over here, you can observe that this two arbitrary constants c1 and c2 is equal to zero. And over here, regarding Wronskian, that is Wronskian, this one. This is the Wronskian, that f1, f2, g1, g2, this determinant. And the result regarding Wronskian is that if this Wronskian is different from zero, that means non-zero. Okay, if this Wronskian is different from zero, then we can say that this system is a homogeneous linear system. These two solutions are linearly independent solution of the homogeneous linear system. Okay, and if this is equal to zero, then the corresponding solution would not be homogeneous at all. You can look at these examples. Suppose we have two solutions, x is equal to e to the power of 5t and y is equal to minus 3 into e to the power of 5t. And another solution is x is equal to e to the power of 3t and y is equal to minus e to the power of 3t. you can check this Wronskian. It becomes as equal to 2 into e to the power of 8t, and this is not equal to 0. So we can say that these two set of solutions, this is the this first one is the first set of solution, and this is the second set of solution. These two set of solutions are linearly independent of each other. So in this way, we generally compute the solution. Let me go to one example. Suppose if you consider this kind of system, you can check all these results. This is this kind of system. Dx dt is equal to 3x plus 4y, and dy dt is equal to twice x plus y. This is a homogeneous system. And in this kind of system, over here, one can check that x is equal to e to the 2 into e to the power of 5t, and y is equal to e to the power of 5t. This is one solution. Similarly, x is equal to e to the power of minus t, and y is equal to minus e to the power of minus t. That is another set of solution. All right. Now, if you find the Wronskian of this system, you will see that the Wronskian is not equal to 0. I am not going to discuss detailed computation over here. I am leaving this computation for your homework. You can check that Wronskian of this system would be not equal to 0. Therefore, you can conclude that this first system and this second system, these two are linearly independent solutions. And in this way, there are some other examples as well. You can go through these examples, this example number 3, example number 2 and all. Now, in this example number 3, you can again check that this is the first system set of solution, and this is the second set of solution, and these two set of solutions are independent of each other. And therefore, they would form the this much they would form the solution of this homogeneous system. But along with this right hand side, dx dt is equal to 5x plus twice y. Dx dt is equal to 5x plus twice y. If you now further add some extra term over here, you see 5 of t is there. This is the extra term, 5 of t. 5x plus twice y plus 5t. Similarly, with this term dy dx is equal to 3x plus 4y, one more extra term is added, plus 17t. So over here, this total system, that would be a non-homogeneous system, and you can check that this would be a this would be a one particular solution. X is equal to t plus 1 and y is equal to minus 5 minus 2. You don't bother about the technique of solution. How did you get this solution? You don't bother about it at all. I shall discuss all of them in the subsequent classes. Okay, and you see over here, this is one solution. This, so this is the second set of solution of this homogeneous system. Then how can we find the general solution of this non-homogeneous system? That would be the linear combination. What kind of linear combination? You see over here, the first system, let me write it over here. The first system has the solution x is equal to 2 e to the power of twice t, and y is equal to minus 3 into e to the power of twice t. Okay, x is equal to 2 into e to the power of twice t, and y is equal to minus 3 into e to the power of twice t. So we can say that one set of solution is x is equal to 2 into e to the power of twice t, 2 into e to the power of twice t. Another is y is equal to minus 3 into e to the power of twice t. This is one set of solution, and another set of solution is x is equal to over here e to the power of 70, and y is equal to again e to the power of 70. So x is equal to e to the power of 70, and y is equal to e to the power of 70. That is another solution. And so these are actually, these two are actually would form the part of complementary function. And what is particular integral? Particular integral. So these two would form the part of complementary function, CA. Okay. And what is the particular integral? The book says that a particular integral is x is equal to e to the power of t plus 1. Let me write it over here. x is equal to how much? Simply t plus 1, t plus 1, and y is equal to how much? Minus 5t minus 2, minus 5t minus 2. So how to find out the solution, the general solution? The general solution is in case of x, you see, in case of x, for x what we have, this is one function, that is actually our f1 function, f1 of t, and this is the second function, that is actually f2 of t. And this is a particular integral, that is actually xp of t. So the general solution should be is equal to c1 into f1 of t plus c2 into f2 of t plus xp. Got it? So this, in this way you will get the solution for x. So x is equal to c1 into e to the power of twice t, c1 into e to the power of twice t plus c2 into e to the power of 7t plus the particular integral over here. The particular integral is t plus 1. So this is the particular, this is the general solution for x. And for y, how to find out the general solution for y? Just exactly in the similar fashion, we will be able to find out the general solution for y. In case of y, you see, this would be our g1 function, and this would be our g2 function. So over here, this is the g1 function of t, and this is g2 function of t, and this would be our particular integral for y, that means y suffix t of t. So in this particular integral over here, you see, particular integral over here, this this one, this g1, g1 is equal to minus 3 into e to the power of twice t. So minus 3, so minus 3 would come, minus 3 into c1 into e to the power of twice t, and g2 is equal to e to the power of 7t, so it remains same. And lastly, this particular integral, that which is equal to minus 5 minus 2. So in this way, you can find out the solution of this non-homogeneous system, this one. Okay, the solution of this non-homogeneous system. So this is the technique of finding the solution of this non-homogeneous system. Now, one question that I shall answer in the next class, that how did we obtain these solutions? X is equal to 2 e to the power of twice t, or x is equal to e to the power of 7t. How did we obtain this solution? I am just giving you a hint so that you can compute them at home. This is an easy part. I am just giving you a hint over here. This dx dt is equal to 5x plus twice y, and dy dt is equal to 3x plus 2y. Let me write it over here. I'm trying to copy this portion. I'm just giving you a hint that how did we obtain this solution. So dx dt is equal to 5x plus twice y, so 5x plus twice y, and dy dt is equal to 3x plus 4y, so 3x plus 4y. Okay, now you can consider trial solution. You can consider trial solution, that x is equal to maybe something like that, say c1 into e to the power of lambda t, or c into e to the power of lambda, forget about c, c is an arbitrary constant, and y is equal to c into e to the power of lambda t. You can find out, you can just put these expressions over here. X is equal to e to the power of lambda t and y is equal to e to the power of lambda t in this solution and find out the value of lambda. Try to find out the value of lambda if possible. So if you become successful, then fine. Otherwise, I shall discuss them in the next in the next day class and continue the discussion in subsequent lectures.
So that's all for this lecture. Thank you for being with us.